Good morning. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to worship. So glad to see you. Delighted that you're here. And we certainly are blessed to have you here with us today as we worship the Lord together. Before we do so, I do want to ask you to take a look here in your bulletin. And there's a sheet that you'll need to hold on to. In just a moment, when it comes time to bless our children, it's a unison prayer. I'll invite you to pray with me. And then on the flip side, don't lose it, because we'll be celebrating communion today. And there is a worship service here on this side for communion that you'll be invited to participate in as well. So, good one to hold on to. Today is the last day that we're taking care registration. That doesn't mean we won't take it later on, but boy, it sure would help if you would do it today as we build our care teams for this coming year. We're entering our 18th year of care here at First Presbyterian. And if you haven't picked up your September-October Upper Room Daily Devotional book, we have several of those that are here. We have the pocket size, we have the larger size for those that would rather use that. If you'd like to take one for family or friends, you know, please do so. Upper Room for September and October. Also, today's the last day to register for our Companions in Christ. I will be placing our order tomorrow. And for those of you who have signed up for it, we'll be getting in touch with you. But this Companions in Christ is a wonderful opportunity to go into the spiritual side of our faith some and learn some things about that and enjoy that and experience God. We're taking recommendations for the office of elder. But now, Sunday, September the 26th, which is homecoming day, is our deadline. And you still have some time, so be praying about someone. You'll find the boxes to receive your recommendation. After you've asked them, place their name here, and then place this. There's a box in the narthex, one down here in the lobby of the educational building. We would greatly appreciate that as we elect four elders for the next class. You know, this is our care month that we rebuild our teams. And this past week, we had 102 contacts. 94 of those were prayers. There were 8 cards mailed out for a total of 102. We're looking at expanding our care ministry again as we're able to do so, and there's a little different plan that we'll be approaching. So just to pique your interest a little bit, we're going to be, instead of going and visiting with a team, you'll be taking on one person. It's almost like the grandparent adoption that we had here. So we'll be looking at that more further, but our care ministry, if you wish to fill in a card to ask for prayer for someone through our care ministry, you'll find baskets, one on the Mulberry side, one here on the Mountain side. Fill those in, place it in the care basket, or you can call in to the church here or email us, or just drop it on put it on a sheet of paper, you know, and put it there. We'll make sure our care ministry gets that. Today, we're looking at a full week as we begin preparations for our fall. Hopefully, prayerfully, we'll be able to follow through on all of these. We're going to step forward in that kind of faith. But please read over your bulletin, your insert that's here for your information. Of course, we covet your daily prayers for Don Alexander and Gwyneth Blackwelder, Sandra Brown, Joe Ganey. Joe is here with us today. He's able to make it back. Joe, welcome. And we're just delighted you're here. It's you know, with the possibility of cataract surgery in my future, I really can't tell who's here, like from the fourth pew back. But I'm trying to look. Is that Mike Throckmorton back here? There he is. Mike had some surgery. He's here also. Mike had hip replacement. Yeah. I was really straining to get you in there, Mike. I mean, I thought it was you, but I wasn't quite sure. So, good to see you. Ronnie Gant, Sharon Hevner. Let's remember Joe Martin and Phyllis Powers. Kat's with us right over here. Boy, she's tough, y'all. Take her as an example. And also Tommy Strapp. Our shut-ins, Kathy Brown. Hey, Kathy, we love you. Bill Crawley, love you, Bill. Dick Lester, Martha Pope, Ann Ramsey, Ruth Randall, Joyce Sellers, Jim Sigmund, Marie Sigmund. God bless y'all. We're praying for you. We miss you here. Friends and family of our church, our military people who are family members and loved ones, Robert McCants and Brandy McCants, Matthew Simmons, Mark Van Brunt, Jackson Smith. Please pray for and participate in our capital campaign, the Golgotha Presbyterian Church in Guatemala. And a church in the Presbytery to pray for daily this week. Their ministry is the Dixon Presbyterian Church over here at Kings Mountain. And one of our former members is the lay pastor over there, Randy Patterson. So we remember Randy and good folks over at Dixon. Of course, we want you to pray for the ministry here at First Presbyterian and the churches throughout the greater Cherville area as well. And we do extend our Christian sympathy to Kat Sigmund, Teddy, her son, and all of the family members that belong to Debbie Sigmund, related to her, children, grandchildren, in-laws, at her recent passing. Her funeral was just this past Sunday, a week ago. We certainly do want to remember you all in our prayers continually. We're celebrating communion today. If you haven't picked up your little communion kit, looks like this. They're right outside this door, and they're on a tray. There's a trick to this if you haven't experienced this before. On top, if you look at it, there is a clear sealer on top, and when you pull that clear sealer back, you'll be exposed to a wafer that's there. So in just a little bit, when we take communion, you can pull that back, and then you reach down and grab the purple tip here and pull it back very carefully, and that's where the juice is contained. We'll be observing communion with these elements in just a little bit. In addition to August being care emphasis, and today especially blessing of our children as they begin a new school year, we also are blessed to have our Presbyterian men and the men's Bible class and men from our congregation who have been leading us in the ministry of music throughout this month, and they will be doing so today. God bless them as they come, and God bless you. We welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. At this time, I'm going to ask you to let your mind settle. Let your heart ease into our call to worship that's here today. Mr. Joe Ganey is going to be playing an instrumental that will hopefully allow you to settle in and think about and ponder upon why we are gathered here today. Joe.
Thank you.
Almighty God, you have sent Jesus to be for us light and truth. Send now your Spirit afresh upon us and grant us grace and strength to follow in his footsteps and to allow him to be our ideal example all the day long. Even now, Lord, as we pray, as he prayed, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. And all of our young members, with or without your book bag, come on up to the front. We're going to do several things. First, we're going to recognize who you are. And then we're going to ask a prayer as a congregation over you. And then we're going to give you a gift to go as part of that. Just line up right there in front. Hey, Kate. Parents in our church family this morning are remembering you and others in this prayer. We're asking God's blessing upon you. So would you please take your prayer, congregation, and pray with me. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give you our schools. We give you all the teachers and staff who work there. We give you all the children who study there. We pray our schools would be places of great discovery, adventure, and creativity. May they be a place where we love to learn and where we learn to love. A place where everyone is respected and all are deeply valued. We ask all of this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. All right. Don't run away. This is a symbol. I hope you'll put it somewhere special. It can be on your book bag. Or it may be on your pocketbook. Or it may be somewhere that you can look at it and know that your congregation here is remembering you in prayer. We're asking God to bless you that you might grow physically, intellectually, and spiritually as well. All right, now I'm going to give y'all a little quiz. If Preacher Bill started the sixth grade in 1961 in the fall, how old would he be now? You can go sit down. Give him a hand, y'all. God bless him. Oh. One of my prayers is you do a whole lot better in school than what I did, okay? I had some wonderful teachers. I just didn't pay attention enough. All right, gentlemen. Amen. Let our prayer continue. It has begun through that wonderful hymn. Let us pray together. Oh, Lord, you bless us so. You bless us by one of the wonderful reasons of allowing us to be in your house together to worship you on this Lord's Day. It is not an entitlement. It is a privilege. And it is a wonderful gift that you've allowed us. We live in a land that allows us to do so, to come together as brothers and sisters in the family of faith, to praise you, to rejoice, to offer our worship. And yes, Lord, even to bring our needs, our cares, our concerns, and even our confessions. We know, Lord, that we're not worthy. We not have earned this by any degree, but it is a gift that says, your sins are forgiven. A gift that says, as you truly repent, so do I wipe the slate clean. A true blessing that allows us to shed our shame and our guilt and to live in the glory and in the joy of knowing Jesus Christ and loving Him as our Savior, following truly His example of life here on this journey of earth. And Lord, we come today, we thank you that we can honor our children, for indeed they are a blessing to us. We know that they are your children, but you've allowed us to partner with you in bringing life into this world. You've granted us a commission to nurture our children into the way of godliness, that they too consciously and within their own heart come to that saving grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. And for many, may it always be said that they cannot consciously remember a time in their own life when they did not know you as their Savior. But as they grow in the faith, so do we pray that we too may continue to grow ever closer and ever stronger as your Holy Spirit leads us this day. In our prayers, it would be short of greed and selfishness if it were just for our own cause that we bring before you. Indeed, we know the Christian way, and the Christian way is prayers of intercession, of care and concern, of sharing the good things that we have with those who have fallen, for whatever the reason might be, into ill health, into sadness and loss and grief, into the areas where we lift one another up by encouraging to stay the course, to walk that straight and narrow way where many fall and go astray. Thank you that we have a constant reminder that you are our Savior and that you are our Lord, and that together we have someone who is responsible to help us and to encourage us as we walk that straight and narrow way. It comes from the Spirit that dwells within and to the Spirit that receives. Thank you for the love of brothers and sisters in the faith. Thank you that we know that continually, throughout the week and throughout the days, in our own circumstances, we have others remembering us before you in prayer. We know, Lord, that you honor the prayer of the righteous. Your word tells us. Our experience assures us. And we just praise you for it. Now we ask your blessing upon this nation and through the difficulties that we are continually facing, whether it be to the health of our nation, physical health, or whether it's through the emotional upheaval that comes our way due to wars and rumors of wars. Sometimes we don't know what to pray for, but we believe that the Spirit intercedes on our behalf and brings before you a refined prayer that is more pure than gold. So this we believe and this we pray. In our world where there's so much violence and hatred and killing, too much us against them, Father, we pray for the unity and we pray for your peace. We yearn for it. We long for it. We pray for it. Now keep your church within her purity to take forth the message of Jesus Christ in our present time and to those who are coming our way, our children and our children's children. Help us to create always a welcoming place for those who will hear and desire to hear and experience the love of Jesus Christ. For it is in your name that we offer our prayer, the prayer I speak, the prayers of our heart. Amen. You know, Jesus said, when you give to the least of these, those who are thirsty, drink; those who are hungry, something to eat; those who are naked, clothing; those who are sick and imprisoned, a visit and a ministry. When you give it to the least of these, he said, you have done it unto me. We thank God for the opportunity that we are called to be his partner, be his hands, his feet, his mouth, to convey his love and encouragement to those about us who have great need. And in doing so, we announce to the world, as we announce to one another, Jesus Christ is Lord. Let us pray. Lord, we dedicate the offerings that you have granted us to share with others to your glory. Bless now, we pray, all that we bring. As you bless those who receive, bless those who give. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Some of you may be unaware of this, but following worship today, there's going to be a meal for teachers and adult leaders in our fellowship hall as they spend an afternoon together, looking and sharpening their own teaching skills, looking at ways that we can enrich the faith of those who attend, well, Sunday school and our youth programs, looking at ways as to how we ourselves might be better equipped to communicate God's love in the way that he has given us. Maybe discover something within ourselves that we have not been aware of in doing just that. Well, the emphasis is here. And I wish to read for our lesson today from the Gospel according to Mark. Mark chapter 10, verses 13 through 16. The basis for our teaching on this giving hearts and hands. Mark 10, 13 through 16. God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He was indignant. And he said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not stop them. For it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms and he laid his hands on them and he blessed them. I believe that God always blesses the reading and the hearing of his holy word. Amen. I think I can safely say that we all agree on the necessity and the importance of a Christian education. And this I can say for a very simple reason. As Christian parents, we are responsible for many things with respect to our children. We provide them, well, with food, with clothing, with shelter, with an education. And sometimes that education continues on. We think, well, for 12 or 13 or 14 years. I meant this when I told Laura when she was in high school, you can go to school as long as you want to go to school. And boy, she took me up on it. But that's all right. We provide them, you see, with love. What is our greatest responsibility as Christian parents? Well, the greatest obligation beyond education and beyond shelter, and beyond food, and beyond clothing, our greatest obligation is to provide our children with Christian education, whether it takes place in the home, in the church, or in the circle of friends in which they are part of. Our text from Mark 10 speaks of this. It's a very familiar text, and yet the point is often missed. Too often people see this story of Jesus and the children as some sentimental, romantic, and warm-hearted incident. They are people who see the story of Jesus and these children with a Jesus who wishes just to smile at them and pat them on the head, who loves children because they are so nice and sweet and innocent. But that's not the point. That is certainly not the point at all. The point, I believe, Jesus knows human life. I mean, of course, he came to earth as God in human form. Now, you can ponder on that all you want to, but that understanding comes through faith and not by any human intelligence whatsoever. But he was here and he knows that children and others have a weakness or an immature faith that can so easily be led away from him. No one knows human nature better than Jesus, and that is why he warns the disciples and he warns us so strongly about our responsibility to children and other young Christians. So when Jesus reprimands the disciples for their behavior, did you notice what he said? "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them." Why does Jesus command this? Well, he gives us the answer in the next line. "For the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." This is the whole point of this passage. The children of believing parents are not received by Jesus as being little heathens who need to be converted. They're not received by Him as being outside of the covenant. They're not received by Him as being outside of the church and outside of salvation. Jesus teaches, and this is the new message because we find it all over the Old Testament, that the kingdom of God also belongs to the children of believing parents. However weak the faith of the parents may be, your children still belong in the covenant faith. And as Christian parents, our children too are sons and daughters of the kingdom of God. Now that's what we mean when we take an infant with the parents that are gathered here. We proclaim this child is a child of God. Though they themselves cannot make the statement, the parents and the covenant family make that commitment, make that declaration that this child is a child of God already. Well, what does it mean that our sons and daughters belong to the kingdom of God? It means that our children are different. Whoa. In a time when we all want to be the same, if you don't believe that, you can sit down with any child and say, what kind of shoes you want to wear to school this year? We got to ride all over creation to find those. You know, that just doesn't stop with small children. When my oldest grandson was graduating from high school, you know, they had to ride practically all over Montgomery, Alabama to find the kind of shoes that he wanted because they couldn't find his pair close by. They just rode and rode and looked and spent time until they finally found a pair. And there are about 15 boys up there all with the same kind of shoes on. But I'm telling you, Christian children are different. They're different. Forget the clothes, forget the shoes. They're different from the children of unbelievers. They are sons and daughters of the kingdom of God. And they didn't earn the privilege either. We didn't earn that privilege for them. So there's no reason here for sinful pride or for a holier-than-thou attitude. The blessings of the kingdom, the great fact that we and our children belong to Jesus. And it's a gift of God's wondrous grace. Let me repeat. Our children are different. They are God's possession. And we as parents are the stewards of His possession. And we are the stewards who must someday answer to the Master for how we have managed what is in our care. But because our children belong to the kingdom, and because they belong to God, because they are different from the children of unbelievers, they must receive a Christian education. They must be brought to Jesus so He can touch them and bless them and change them and shape their hearts. This way, as the child grows up, he or she is brought to a full understanding of how different and how special and of how important he or she really is in the eyes of God. Apple of God's eye, cherished. Jesus told parables about that, didn't he? About a lost coin, about a lost sheep, about a lost pearl, about a lost boy. How precious are those who belong to the Lord. Christian education makes our children different from the children of the world. They're different already. Christian education merely recognizes and states, which is already a fact, that the children of believers are different. They're holy. They're special. In many places throughout Scripture, they teach the necessity of a good, basic, solid, biblical Christian education for God's children. One of the favorite Christian education passages that we read is in Deuteronomy 6, where God says, "These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads and write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates." And according to this passage, Christian education must take place all day long and all year long. It's not reserved for just a single day of the year. Another beautiful Christian education passage is found in Psalm 78. "We will not hide them from their God, we will not hide them from their children. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, His power and His wonders that He has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob, and He established the law in Israel, which He commanded our forefathers to teach their children." So the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. What is hoped for is a goal or a result that we call a Christian education. The psalmist tells us, "Then they would put their trust in God, and they would not forget His deeds, but would keep His commands." I think we all know the words of the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 6. "Father, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and in the instruction of the Lord." The message of Scripture is clear. We parents have a responsibility. More than that, we have an obligation to give our children a good, sound, solid, biblical Christian education. And in each instance, Scripture tells us that this is our duty because our children, well, they belong to God. They're part of the kingdom already. The question that confronts us this morning is this: how do we give our children such an education? How are we to bring them to Jesus so that He may touch them and bless them and change them and shape their hearts? And there are three answers to this: parents, church, and their friends. Parents, church, and friendships. Those three answers must give them a Christian education, and will. I like to think of the home, of the church, and as a fellowship, to borrow an image from the Presbyterian pilgrimage, like the legs of a three-legged stool. As you know, all three legs of a stool are needed to give it stability. Without one of the legs, the whole business, well, it'll just fall down. Likewise, a Christian education in the home, in the church, and the school, all three must work and stand together, or the whole business will come crashing down. Now, the first leg of the stool is the Christian home. This is the most important element, I think, of a godly, fearing Christian education. The Christian education received in the home is the basis for any education received in the church or with friends. If the home doesn't do its job, if the parents do not teach about Jesus in the home, the efforts of the church, well, and the friends in this area will fall by the wayside. All Christian education must begin in the home. No parent can ever escape this responsibility and think, well, I'm just going to leave it to somebody else. I'll just leave it to church. I'll just leave it to my child's friends. I'll just leave it to Aunt Lottie. I'll just leave it to Granny. No, the parent. The second leg of the school is the church. Christian education must take place in the church. In the church, the children must also be brought to Jesus so that he may touch them and bless them and change them and shape their hearts. And once again, this must be done because our children belong to the Lord. This means that children ought to attend weekly worship service. It also means that church ought to offer an excellent church school program, as well as various youth groups and societies in which our children and youth are taught and study the church's beautiful doctrines about Christ and salvation. There are parents who don't think this is at all important, but don't forget the goal. We want to bring our children to Jesus so that he may touch them and bless them and change and shape their lives. And that third leg, well, sometimes I think this is the most important for a child. And we read and we talk so much about something called peer pressure. Where do you get peer pressure? Not from somebody that I don't care about. My peer pressure always came from my friends, or those that I thought was my friends anyway. A Christian friendship is one in which the Lord is openly honored and feared and served. Let us listen and be obedient to the words of Jesus. Let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. In the home, in the church, in their circle of friends. Bring out children to Jesus so he may touch them, so he may bless them, so he may change them, so they may have their heart changed to follow his way, his truth, and his life. One of the ways that we hear the Lord speak to us through his word, of course, and through ways in which we see his word interpreted in image. One of those is through this symbol that we come to today. Some churches, they call it Holy Communion. Others call it the Lord's Supper. Some call it the Eucharist. But whatever it is called, it is the Lord's table. And it's to the Lord's table this morning that you are invited. Those of you who know and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Those who know that he is truly the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes to the Father except by him. Those who would call him Savior. Those of you who would call him Lord. Those of you who are in good standing in some Christian church, and those of you who would receive this as a means of grace that your own faith might grow, to you, the invitation is now extended. Let us give thanks to God. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and our greatest joy is to give you thanks and praise. O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe, who blesses us with such precious things as a gift of life, who blesses us by our union, inviting us with you to bring continued life into the world, by blessing us to grant us a responsibility to lead these little hearts and these little souls to a saving knowledge and an understanding about Jesus Christ in their lives. How wonderful and marvelous it is. We praise you and we join our voice with prophets, with martyrs, with all of the faithful of every time and place who forever worship you as we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The Apostle Paul has written to the church at Corinth, and so he has written to us. But on the night when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was betrayed, he gathered with his disciples there in an upper room. They were celebrating the Passover. And at the Passover, we know this Jewish holy day became a Christian holy day. And Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, he broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And following the supper, he took one of the seven cups, the cup of salvation, and he says, "This proclaims my death, the pouring out and the shedding of my blood, my death, until you taste of it again in the kingdom of heaven for the forgiveness of your own sins." As often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim all that God has done for you through me. Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim all that God has done for us through Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for inviting each of us. And thank you for inviting us together to be at this holy feast. May we find its way. May we discover its words. May we experience this example deep within, as our heart and our soul and our spirit yearns for closeness with you, our Lord. Go with us as you bless us to be your ambassadors now to the world. We pray in your holy and precious name. Amen. Please join me as we sing our closing hymn this morning. Across town on Church Street this morning, there's a young man who grew up in this congregation. Then he went off to college, Lenore Ryan. While he was there, not only did he receive a diploma, he also received a wife. And being of Lutheran influence, I think she must have persuaded him to follow the Lutheran way. We'll forgive him of that. But then he went to work for the Boy Scouts of America. And Scott Holmesley has said, in doing that, service for others. He felt like it was a service organization. Leonard, he said, something was missing. Something was missing. He found that in answering God's call to ordain ministry. I don't know if you're being called to ordain ministry or not, But you may be standing here right now or listening on live stream or sometimes this afternoon on YouTube and on the recording. You feel like something is missing. Something is missing. Give me a call, and I'll get you in touch with someone that we will be prayerfully sitting down and speaking with you about what could be missing in your life that should not be. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift His countenance upon you and grant you His peace, now and forevermore.